You know, I was nearly 40 by the time I took vows as a Jesuit brother. I'd had a pretty full life before that. I'd been a college professor. I'd traveled around the world and spent 2 years in Africa in the Peace Corps. I'd published dozens of scientific papers, and yet none of those things allowed me to use all of my talents the way that being a Jesuit had. A couple of years ago, I was asked to do a Bible study group. I'm thinking Catholics don't do Bible studies, you know. And to do a Bible study group in Houston. I'm going, Catholics definitely don't do Bible studies in Texas. To do a Bible study group in Houston with a bunch of astronauts. Astronauts, oh, I could do that, yeah. So I wound up at a dinner evening of about 12 couples, all of them astronauts and spouses. One of the guys, half of them were Catholic, as it turns out, so much for Catholics not doing Bible studies. One of the guys came up to me and said, you know, I just want to let you know, I believe in the absolute truth that creation was made in the 6 days, just as described in the book of Genesis. And that's my religion. I just want to let you know that ahead of time. And I'm thinking, you know, have you actually read Genesis? Where it says the world is flat and it's covered with a dome and there's water above and below the dome. You know, where does the shuttle go?
Strategy. I know you're coming back with reinforcements, something. I know there's a plan. You can tell me. No other human will ever know.
There is no plan.
In the solar system, a probe descends through a thick, poisonous atmosphere. It is both a time capsule and time machine, unlocking secrets of the ancient past, while revealing how a world can turn from possibly habitable to horrible. The location? Venus. Our sister planet has much to tell us about our own and exoplanets, helping ignite a scientific renaissance for our universe. The mission, brought to you by NASA Goddard and its partners, is aptly named Da Vinci Plus, the first U.S. probe mission to Venus in over 40 years. With the probe acting as chemistry lab and photographer, other cameras will map and gather additional views of the planet from above, providing a new study of Venus that has scientific implications well beyond our own solar system. Da Vinci Plus will give us a new understanding of planetary evolution. Launching in 2029, 3 years will be spent exploring our celestial neighbor. Da Vinci Plus, coming soon to a planet near you.
Why do you think that Truman has never come close to discovering the true nature of his world until now?
We accept the reality of the world with which we're presented. It's as simple as that.
NASA's Rob Simon made this, and it had wide appeal too. For example, it ended up as the default background on the iPhone.
I didn't even know until I bought an iPhone. And turned it on and kind of did a little happy dance.
Simon's job is...
it's primarily taking data and making pictures out of it.
That's what this is. A composite of data sets from several different instruments translated into a picture.
To us, the really cool thing was the data set. Up until that point, there was no realistic color map of the globe anywhere.
So the land layer here comes from
the moderate resolution imaging spectral radiometer aboard Terra.
And the tricky part here was the weather.
So we actually had to take clouds out.
They stashed the clouds for later, went onto the ocean. That came from an instrument that measures phytoplankton in the sea.
Where it was low, I colored it dark blue because they're low mostly in mid-oceans. And then where it was a little bit higher, it was like a little bit brighter green.
Then add the clouds back in.
There's a small problem with it because there's a very slight gap in between each orbit.
So some of those are painted on.
It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be.
I'm sorry, Reverend Morgan. I was going too fast.
Gwilym, if you had been watching your driving instead of thinking of Essie, this wouldn't have happened.
It wasn't his fault. The horses ran away. Uncle Evan, you can't blame Gwilym. It was just an accident.
You're to blame for this. Evil has stalked this train ever since we were foolish enough to bring you with us.
Emma, that's enough. You've gone a bit too far.
You defend her only because she's your niece. She's a daughter of Satan, Evan. I've told you before. Mark my words. Satan rides her shoulder like a dark cloud.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let's see just how evil NASA is. First, we're going to look at Earth's orbital speed around the sun. How fast does Earth move around the sun? 66,600 miles per hour. Speed of the globe's orbit. Next. Curvature in 1 mile squared. According to Pythagorean theorem, 0.67 feet of drop. 8 inches converted to feet is 0.66667 feet. Curvature in 1 mile squared, check. Earth's axial tilt, 23.4, but when you take 23.4 and subtract it from 90, a right angle, you get, believe it or not, 66.6.
Yeah, this wagon could sure use some fixing. Well, maybe my boys and I can help you with it.
The Eternal Brethren take no charity, sir.
I'm sorry, what's that?
The Eternal Brethren. We are the people preparing for the last conflict with Satan, the Prince of Darkness, who all men must meet someday.
A little more heft, brethren. It wouldn't hurt to say a prayer as we put our shoulders to it.
Evan, Evan, you couldn't listen to me before. Now maybe you will. There's something you must see.
Emma, I'll join you as soon as we get the wagon upright.
No, no. This is more important than any wagon. Come along.
Oh, all right, Emma. Remember, brethren, the right prayer can increase your strength tenfold.
Come along.
If you start here and you go around long enough in the same direction, you wind up in the place you started from. Yes, Thomas.
Why don't we fall off when we walk underneath, Miss Sarah?
Because of a force called gravity.
What does gravity look like?
What is gravity?
You have no idea. Okay, next question.
I don't know.
Nobody in the entire world knows why that falls.
So what is pushing this?
Here. Why does that fall?
Gravity is something we can't see. But we know it's a great invisible force that keeps us all here on Earth. Some of you know what a magnet is, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Well, then let's think of it like that. Gravity could be called a kind of magnet. It's a natural force that keeps us all from flying off into space.
Newton didn't know.
We can describe it pretty accurately, but no one knows why.
We can describe gravity. We can say what it does to other things. We can measure it, predict with it.
I don't need a computer to get a kid interested in that. To spend a week playing with gravity and trying to understand it and come up with reasons why.
Well, so what is pushing this?
I don't know.
Nobody knows why.
So Newton simply threw his hands up and said, I don't know. So I'm going to invent something called gravitational pull.
Again, axial tilt confirmed. Now let's take a look at the Antarctic and Arctic circles. Oh, did you look at that? 66.6 degrees north and 66.6 degrees south.
Finally tonight, she's out of this world, the current commander of the International Space Station, about to break a big record tonight. Here's ABC's Gio Benitez.
They call it the Peggy Factor, Mission Control's code word for the way superstar astronaut Peggy Whitson always gets the job done.
I love it up here.
Tonight, Commander Whitson making history with her record for any American. By the time she lands in September, her tally will be 666 days.
666 days in space.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Thing, didn't we?
We were hidden in the first booster rocket to separate. Splashed down back in the Atlantic just as planned. We ain't going nowhere.
Thank you.
I could turn the page and time that I'd rearrange just a day or two. Close my eyes. Then I couldn't find a way, so I settled for one day to believe in you. Tell me lies. Tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. Tell me lies. You can't disguise. Tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. Although I'm not making plans, I hope that you understand there's a reason why. Close your eyes. No more broken hearts, we're better off apart. Let's give it a try. Tell me lies. Tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. Tell me lies. Oh no, you can't disguise. No, you can't disguise. Tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. If I could turn the page and time that I'd rearrange just a day or two. Close my eyes. I couldn't find a way, so I settled for one day to believe in you. Tell me lies. Tell me lies, tell me sweet little lies. Tell me lies.
I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process.
Now let's go over the diameter of the moon. This is a new one. I actually didn't know. It's 2,160 miles, but you take 6 times 6 times 6, there you go, 2160. The surface temperature of Uranus. Oh, there you go, negative 216, which is 6 times 6 times 6, 216. Oh, you thought we were done. Let's do Pluto's orbital velocity. Scroll down here. Oh, there we go. 666. The speed of sound in knots. Speed of sound? Oh, well, look at that. 666 knots.
We were always told that the world is flat.
You were told right. Don't listen to her. I've been patient with you, Sarah. Lord knows I've been patient. But now your words have revealed you.
The law of gravity was discovered by Sir Isaac Newton in 1687. That's almost 200 years ago, Uncle Evan.
But there is only one law. The law of God. If our divine maker had meant for us to walk upside down, he would have put feet on our hands.
You want to buy a ticket to Antarctica? You can't. Because only the government and the Illuminati have access to Antarctica. Wake up, because if we go there, we'll be able to see that Antarctica is the edge of the flat Earth.
Personally, I think the unconquered South Face is the only one worth scaling. It's a 20,000-foot sheer wall of ice, but that's never stopped me before.
Now, one thing I really want your generation to embrace is that the Earth is a closed system. We cannot leave the Earth. There's no place to go.
Although we weren't able to shatter that highest, hardest glass ceiling this time, thanks to you, it's got about 18 million cracks in it.
And it may be hard to see tonight, but we are all standing under a glass ceiling right now.
And the light is shining through like never before, filling us all with the hope and the sure knowledge that the path will be a little easier next time.
NASA's Perseverance rover will finally reach Mars tomorrow afternoon.
We've been following the spacecraft's progress since it blasted off 7 months ago. KTLA's Lou Parker has more.
And liftoff.
Adventures assembled. NASA's Perseverance rover rocketing off on a 292 million mile mission to the Red Planet. Packed tightly inside the capsule, the most scientifically sophisticated spacecraft ever sent to another world.
This particular rover has some of the most complex systems on board that we've ever attempted to launch or send to Mars.
Perseverance, our rover, is the biggest, heaviest, and most complex rover we've ever sent to Mars.
It's just a car-sized rover, but there is so much capability on that rover to make sure that it is densely packed with a lot of tools that we can use to explore the Martian environment and learn a lot about it.
The 2015 movie The Martian, directed by Ridley Scott and starring Matt Damon, gave us a glimpse into what life would be like on Mars. But in order to achieve such incredibly realistic visuals, the movie used a ton of visual effects, and not just for the obvious shots like, you know, the shots of Mars, but for many subtle details you wouldn't have even thought of. So here's how they made the visual effects for the movie The Martian. Most of the VFX provided were thanks to the visual effects companies Framestore and MPC, MPC being responsible for the shots on the ground on Mars, while Framestore took care of the shots in space. Most of the shots of Matt Damon were filmed on a green screen backdrop, but that was only half of the job, or in some cases a very small part of the job, as all of the scenes needed to be enhanced with CGI later on in post-production. And for The Martian, it was a little more involved than just sticking on a backdrop, because on Mars the air is approximately 96% carbon dioxide, so naturally, to look believable, the astronauts needed to be wearing spacesuits with glass visors. The only problem is that glass would have reflected all of the lights, set, camera, and crew. So in order to overcome this problem, they filmed actors without any visors, and added them on later digitally in post-production. For some of these shots, in order to get the correct lighting and reflections on the visors, they had to create an entire computer-generated build of the live-action scenes. However, not all scenes were filmed in front of a green screen, as some of the shots in The Martian were shot in Jordan, which does have a very similar-looking landscape to Mars, and provided an amazing realistic environment. But unfortunately, the sky being blue meant that every shot of the sky needed to be adjusted, or even completely replaced. In order to make this easier, MPC invented a custom-made filter that was basically an advanced color corrector and hue adjuster that they turned into a gizmo in Nuke called Earth to Mars. This gave them control over how much blue to take out of the shot and how much to colorize it with another color, and also meant that they didn't have to tediously rotoscope every single shot.
NASA.
becoming 100% crystal clear that you and the other space programs that are in operation are connected and are deceiving the entire world. More and more people are waking up every single day, and we are now able to see right through you.
Force field. It's a dome right at the edge of the arena.
The great reformer Jean Calvin, also known as John Calvin, called Copernicus a dreamer who has a spirit of bitterness and contradiction. Reprove everything and prevent the order of nature. We will see some who are so deranged, Calvin said, not only in religion, but who in all things reveal their monstrous nature, that they will say that the sun does not move and that it is the earth which shifts and turns. When we see such minds, we must indeed confess that the devil possesses them, and that God sets them before us as mirrors in order to keep us in his fear. So it is with all who argue out of pure malice, and that happily make a show of their imprudence. When they are told this is hot, they will reply, no, it is plainly cold. When they are shown an object is black, they will say, no, it is white, and vice versa. Just like the man who said that the snow is black, for although it is perceived and known all to be white, yet he clearly wished to contradict the fact. And so it is that they are madmen who try to change the natural order and even to dazzle eyes and benumb the senses. Do you think Calvin knew how the Freemasons were used by the Jesuits? When they are shown an object is black, they will say it is white.
We're talking about our government here.
No, we're talking about a crime, Bill, pure and simple. Y'all got to start thinking on a different level like the CIA does.
When Alan Dulles brought in all the Nazi scientists and so forth, they went to two places. They went to CIA and they went to the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which in our world we call it not a space agency. And as Kathy O'Brien has said so clearly, that's where the bulk of the mind control is.
We were never able to see stars from the lunar surface or on the daylight side of the moon by eye without looking through the optics. I don't recall during the period of time that we were photographing the Sonar Corolla what stars we could see.
I don't remember seeing any.
The sky is a deep black when viewed from the moon, as it is when viewed from cislunar space, the space between the Earth and the moon. The Earth is the only visible object other than the sun that can be.
The biggest visual surprise was just how black the sky was. You have a brilliant sun, brighter than any sun you normally would see even here in New Mexico. You have these extraordinarily high mountains. We were in a valley deeper than the Grand Canyon. But then you have this black sky, a sky blacker than black, as the old Viticon expression used to be.
When you're in space and you're looking into deep space and you're on the sun side of the orbit, the sunlight washes out all the starlight, so you can't see any stars, just like here on Earth. But then when you look out into deep space away from the sun, it's the darkest black you can imagine.
And we cannot see stars.
Whilst in space, have you ever looked away from Earth into the black void?
You can see the stars.
Oh yeah,
You know, and pretty much all the time you can see the stars.
But we can also see stars if we're on the dark side of Earth and planets.
When I look out at the stars and I see, you know, so many stars and planets, and
if you're there in the daytime of the moon, you see a full night sky of stars.
Mm-hmm.
Even with the sun
in the sky as well.
There really are billions and billions of stars, and you can see them. In fact, they're so numerous, it's very difficult to pick out the constellations you and I see here on the ground. And I live in Colorado, and you get up on a clear night in Colorado up in the mountains where there's no light, and you can see all these stars. We'll multiply that by 1,000. That's what it's like in space. And then when you're outside doing a spacewalk, and you have that one or two opportunities where you can let your eyes adjust, you can start to notice that some of the stars have colors we don't see here on the ground.
You know, there are a lot of lights out there. There are a lot of stars, and they're all fixed relative to each other.
The sky, of course, was black.
The sky is almost white with the light of the universe, with the uncountable number of stars.
The Earth's circumference in nautical miles? 21,600. There you go, ladies and gentlemen. Again, 600 times 6 times 6. Another coincidence, 21,600. How far is Mars from the Sun? Oh, well, 1.666 astronomical units. Now let's look at Ceres synodic period. And just as you expected, 666 again. The devil's in the details, ladies and gentlemen. Saturn's orbital distance in kilometers. Let's take a look at the numbers. Oh, 1,426,666,000. States in Psalm 2, the kings of the earth have taken up arms against the Lord and his anointed, saying, let us break their chains and cast them asunder. And God, who sits in heaven, laughs and says he will hold them in derision. masses have been duped on such a grand scale, ladies and gentlemen. And if someone believes in a creation that does not exist, he also necessarily believes in a creator that does not exist.
I'm Jim Bridenstine, the NASA Administrator. Thank you to the International Astronautical Congress for providing us with this opportunity. I am here today to talk about the future, a future that is peaceful, free of conflict, and one where humanity explores and develops the Moon and Mars in harmony. Achieving this future will require both vision and action, which is why it's my pleasure to sign, on behalf of the United States of America, the Artemis Accord.
Artemis is known as the hunter goddess in Greek mythology. This goddess has the bow and arrow as one of her symbols, her favorite weapon. Because of that, the goddess is usually depicted in the arts with her inseparable bow. The goddess of the hunt is the daughter of Zeus with her lover Leto, and she is Apollo's twin sister. But she was born one day before her brother and actually helped her mother deliver Apollo. When they were still babies, they and their mother were chased by the ignominious snake Python, but that creature was killed by Apollo when he became an adult. One of the traits of the goddess is that she is a virgin deity. From an early age, the goddess made a vow of chastity after witnessing all the suffering her mother had endured to bring Apollo into the world, and she remains pure for all eternity. For having helped her mother in childbirth, women in ancient Greece prayed that the goddess would help them during labor. Although she was born in Delos, the sacred island of the twin gods, Artemis dwells in the forests and mountains of Arcadia. Artemis was regarded as the goddess of wildlife. She was truly passionate about the art of hunting and wandered through the woods in search of the most glorious prey. The goddess was followed by a procession of wild and oceanic nymphs, her companions. All her companions also had the duty to remain virgin and pure, not to smear the image and reputation of the virgin goddess. One time, while the goddess and her nymphs were bathing in a fountain, they were spotted by the hunter Actaeon. He was dazzled by the divine beauty of the goddess of the hunt. But the goddess did not allow herself to be raped by the profane gaze, fixated on her naked body, which no man had ever seen. The goddess turned the hunter into a deer, and then he was chased by his own hunting dogs, who caught and shattered him. Like a good hunter, the goddess also had her own hunting dogs, from which no prey could hide. But the animal that represented the goddess of the hunt was the deer. Artemis captured some and tied them to her carriage. Sitting on it, pulled by sacred bucks, the goddess flew through the air. Agamemnon, the great leader of the Achaeans during the Trojan War, sacrificed one of Artemis's sacred deer, and, if that wasn't enough, he claimed that not even the hunter could kill that animal with his accuracy. This enraged Artemis, who, as punishment, prevented the Greek army from leaving for Troy. To make great peace with the goddess, Agamemnon had to sacrifice his beloved daughter, and, only after such a sacrifice, the Greeks set sail for war. The goddess's most ruthless side was also shown when Niobe proudly stated that her children were more beautiful than the descendants of the goddess Leto. Apollo and Artemis punished Niobe, killing all her sons with accurate arrow strikes. According to some versions of the myth, Artemis was particularly fond of Orion, a talented and giant hunter. But Orion was killed by Artemis after a trick pulled by Apollo, who deceived the goddess, jealous of that relationship. In another version, Orion attempted to rape Artemis, and so she sent a huge scorpion to kill the giant. The goddess was also depicted as a lunar goddess, like her brother Apollo, who took Helios's place as the sun god. Artemis occupied the position of the goddess of the moon, replacing Selene. According to other versions, Artemis, Selene, and Hecate were all lunar goddesses, since each goddess represents a moon phase. Artemis is one of the most adored Greek deities in ancient Greece. several cities were consecrated in honor of the goddess, and throughout the Hellenic world, there are countless temples edified to worship the goddess. Nevertheless, the most famous is undoubtedly the glorious temple of Artemis in Ephesus. The great temple was so majestic that it was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. In the temple of Ephesus, located in Asia Minor, the goddess was worshipped differently. There, she was seen as a goddess of fertility, and her image with multiple breasts symbolized her ability to raise men. The goddess was revered in ancient Rome with her Latin name of Diana, whose main temple was on Mount Aventine. With the expansion of the Roman Empire, her cult spread throughout Europe. According to some versions of Arthurian legends, the famous Lady of the Lake descended from Diana, the goddess of the hunt in Rome. Artemis is an ambiguous goddess. Sometimes she is generous and benevolent. However, she can also be ruthless and rancorous. This duality makes her one of the most interesting goddesses of Greek mythology.
The principles described in the Artemis Accords are what will create a bright and prosperous future that we all want for ourselves and for generations to come. These principles are grounded in the Outer Space Treaty, the very foundation of international space law. The Outer Space Treaty is over 50 years old, but it doesn't look a day over 35. The Accords both reinforce and implement the obligations of the Outer Space Treaty. For the first time, we are establishing consequences for Outer Space Treaty compliance. Specifically, if a nation does not comply with the Outer Space Treaty, it cannot be a part of the Artemis program. The principles of the Accords are simple, intuitive, and universal. Transparency, rendering emergency assistance to astronauts in distress, respecting heritage sites, the public release of scientific data for all to enjoy. These are the values we want to take with us to the stars. Moreover, the Artemis Accords affirm the simple contention that we can, in fact, extract and utilize space resources. Countries and companies should be able to enjoy the fruits of their labor, and all such activities can and will be done in full compliance with the Outer Space Treaty. We also need to abide by the principle of due regard and utilize safety zones wherein nations will be responsible for public notification of where they are operating and to coordinate with any affected party to avoid harmful interference as required by the Outer Space Treaty. There is a lot more in the Artemis Accords, but fundamentally the Accords are about avoiding conflict, transparency, public registration, deconflicting activities. These are the principles that will preserve peace. So many conflicts in history have been caused by misperception and confusion. The Artemis Accords are crafted to prevent conflict before it happens. The nations which are participating in Artemis and are here today are committing to the principles of the Accords. However, the Artemis Accords were written to be inclusive, and any responsible spacefaring nation should be able to abide by these principles, and I really hope all countries will. I also want to emphasize that the Artemis Accords are the beginning, not an ending. The experiences we gain through the Artemis program and these accords will help to inform future multilateral discussions at the United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space and other international forums. The time has come to operationalize the Outer Space Treaty, and that is exactly what the Artemis Accords do. I am so proud to be here signing the Artemis Accords with this founding group of nations. The combined NASA and Department of State team has worked tirelessly with our partner space agencies and foreign ministries to craft the Artemis Accords.
Let's take a look at the spacesuits of the Artemis generation.
Everybody. seem to have a problem with our main engine.
It was the first sign all was not well. The faces of the team said it all. Israel's dream of landing on the moon dissolving into bitter disappointment.
We had a failure in the spacecraft. We unfortunately have not managed to land successfully. We are the seventh country to orbit the moon and the fourth to reach the moon's surface. And it's a tremendous achievement up to now.
Well, we didn't make it, but we definitely tried.
A spacecraft selfie taken minutes earlier promised so much, but an engine fault caused it to crash, scattering into thousands of pieces.
In other breaking news, the world is round, not flat.
You went too far, you would fall off. Now the earth is round, if the shape change again, everybody would have start love. The average man can't prove up most of the things that he chooses to speak of. And still run research and find out the root of the truth that you seek of. Scholars teach in universities and claim that they're smart and cunning. Tell them find a cure when we sneeze and that's when their nose start running. And the rich get fixed up when we get cut. Wanna heal them broken bones in the bush with the wet mud. Can you re-science? Can you re-stars? Can you make peace? Can you fight war? Can you milk cows, even though you drive cars? Can you survive against all odds now?
It's an unfathomable blackness, like texture you feel like you could stick your hand into.
Why has nobody been to the moon in such a long time?
That's not an 8-year-old's question. That's my question. I want to know, but I think I know. Because we didn't go there, and that's the way it happened. And if it didn't happen, it's nice to know why it didn't happen. So in the future, if we want to keep doing something, we need to know why something stopped in the past that we wanted to keep it going.
I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again.
People come out and they've run out of anecdotes, you know, and they just start making stuff up.
Yeah.
Like that Neil Armstrong guy. Have you seen him on the talk shows?
Neil Armstrong, you mean the first man to walk on the moon?
Talk about a fish story.
Yeah.
Man, and they're buying it.
Okay. Yeah.
Now we're through the looking glass here, people. White is black, and black is white.
Very quickly, Rome jumped upon this new model of the universe, and Jesuits like Christopher Clavius used Copernicus and his work to fabricate the Gregorian calendar, the calendar we all use. Rightly did the prophet Daniel say in chapter 7, verse 23, that during his vision, a being standing near him said, "The fourth beast shall be a fourth kingdom on the earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it into pieces. The 10 horns are 10 kings who shall rise from this kingdom, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue 3 kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and intend to change times and laws. And the saints shall be given into his hand for a time."
is a remarkable achievement. What you're seeing here is the last photon orbit. What you are seeing is evidence of an event horizon. By laying a ruler across this black hole, we now have visual evidence for a black hole. We now know that a black hole that weighs 6.5 billion times what our sun does exists in the center of M87. And this is the strongest evidence that we have to date for the existence of black holes. And it is also consistent, the shape of this shadow, to the precision of our measurements with Einstein's predictions. The bright patch in the south that you see tells us that material moving around the black hole is moving at light speeds, which is also consistent with our simulations and predictions. And this image forges a clear link now between supermassive black holes and the engines of bright galaxies. We now know clearly that black holes drive large-scale structure in the universe from their home in these galaxies. And we now have an entirely new way of studying general relativity in black holes that we never had before. And as with all great discoveries, this is just the beginning. So imaging a black hole doesn't come easily. I can tell you that from personal experience, as can many people here in the audience.
They revealed the first image of a black hole today, and that looks exactly to me like the good old black sun, okay, the same old, and we were looking at this yesterday, and I showed you how they actually refer to these as dark stars, okay? That is a literal alternative term for these because of the mass of a million times our sun that is in the center of this, so they claim. Okay? This is what they tell us, okay? So they reveal this first picture of it, and it looks just strikingly like a black sun, because that's really what it is. And I just want to show you, it's like, how do you ignore these things when they're doing it right in front of your face? Now, I showed you about Enoch and the courses of the luminaries yesterday, and you need to understand that there is a dark side to everything, all right? And this is real stuff, and it's common, you know, information that you can get, but people are just unaware of the power of this and what it really means. This Enochian magic was the work of a couple of guys named John Dee and Edward Kelly. And it was also picked up by the likes of Aleister Crowley. Let's see, all kinds of interesting names in here that have picked up on this. But John Dee and Edward Kelly were the fathers of it. And those guys were the early astronomers. These were the ones who set the pace for modern science, okay, through alchemy and through sigils that they would conjure these spirits and garner the knowledge. This is just simply how it works. It is a spiritual war, and they use these sigils of various kinds to bring in these various spirits and gain the knowledge, but they have to give up things in the end, namely their soul. And this is what they do. The scrying, the black magic rituals, it's all very common. It's alive and well today, except now they call these people NASA and Space Israel. Okay, that's the only difference between then and now. It's gotten a little more sophisticated. Okay? Now, I was showing you also, or did I show you? I can't remember. The pop culture related to this. The black hole sun, the dark star. Black hole sun. I mean, if you haven't heard that song, then I don't know where you've been, but this is one of the most popular songs of all time, at least in that genre. But this gentleman, Chris Cornell, who wrote the song, suicided himself in 2017. Okay, Black Hole Sun. Another very famous entertainer who died in 2016, named David Bowie, his last record was called Black Star. Okay, very interesting album cover there. And this is all Enochian magic. That's what it is. And he died at the age of 69, just 2 days after the release of this album. And if you were to look into this, it would make you vomit. Because, I mean, there was a video attached to this album of his called Black Star. And if you look at this, man, it is some of the most unbelievably evil, in-your-face, blasphemous garbage that you could ever, ever watch. But yet, it's some of the most popular things in our entire society. So between these two, right, Chris Cornell and David Bowie and their deaths, just to illustrate how these rituals actually run. If we just go back to David Bowie's death on January 10th, 2016, to tomorrow, because today's already spent 1188 days. There's your 923 that people see everywhere for years. 923. Okay? The 1188, the 332, but the 1188 is interesting. That's the number of chapters in our King James Bible. But it's also something else very interesting. Chris Cornell died on May the 18th, 2017, to tomorrow, and it's an interesting 693 days. The three of the most magic numbers there are. Think about this, okay? But let's just do a little something. We're going to take David Bowie's 1188 days ago, okay? And we're going to add Chris Cornell's 693 days. And we're going to see what we get. And it's quite telling, if you ask me. 1881? How is that even possible? Because it's black magic. Because you're involved in a spiritual war, whether you like it or not. And Jesus Christ is the only victor in that war. So you need him above all things. And I hope that this, you know, makes sense to somebody and you realize that everything you're being told, I mean, is a lie with little bits of truth mixed into it. And some eye candy and CGI to keep you just kind of moving along as they destroy your very soul. That's what's happening. That's their black hole. Their black hole sun. That's what all of this is, you guys. All of it. So, seek Jesus first, foremost, and always. Peace and grace to you. Oh, man, there's so many things, so many insane things going on right now that just make you want to just cringe and you don't know which way to go, right? I mean, this, all these events happening in the world right now to keep the minds busy and people just yearning for a beer and their television, you know? But the fact of the matter is, there is a very serious spiritual war going on for your soul. And they're about to have some groundbreaking results come from a black hole hunting event horizon telescope. Now, this is crazy because the whole flat earth situation, right? The firmament. That's what you're looking into when you look up, okay? And it's like everything else of God. Even the angels seek to know this stuff. Even Satan, one of the angels, seeks to know these things, because he doesn't know all these things. These black holes, and this just came to me as I was looking around today, are nothing more than the portals, if you will, of the sun and the moon and whatnot that are explained in Enoch. Okay? Now, Enoch is a legitimate book just based on the fact that it's mentioned all over the Bible. And this is where I came across this today, is in Jude. Okay? I was just led there. And it comes to where, you know, the wandering stars, whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. Now, as far as dissecting this prophecy, I just see things that just come into my spirit that I'm like, wait a minute, there's something going on here. That they're wandering stars, okay, which we can refer to angels as stars, fallen angels, wandering stars, all these various characterizations, but we know that we're looking up at the hosts of heaven, but we're looking at it through a firmament, through a glass, through a sea of whatever God has there, because that's as far as you can go. I mean, they've even tried to shoot things through this stuff, you guys. I mean, you can look this stuff up yourself, but they literally shot nukes like almost 700 miles up into the space. They can't go any further. You can only go a certain distance, and that's it. Nothing goes any further. And that's the way it is. And these black holes, I believe, are just portals, because they see them everywhere. And if you read Enoch, right, he talks about all the portals. You know, he was shown by the angel Uriel, you know, the first law of the luminaries. The luminary, the sun, has its rising in the eastern portals of the heaven and its setting in the western portals of heaven. And I saw six portals in which the sun rises, and six portals in which the sun sets. The moon rises and sets in these portals. You see what I mean? There is so many things going on up there that when we're looking at it, it's like, I love images, but I don't have a lot pertaining to this. But basically, we're looking through here, and we see these luminaries and everything that's set in the firmament, but we don't know what we're looking at, absolutely. We really don't. But the powers that be have a much better idea than we do. They know what it is, and they know that they want to ascend there without facing any judgment, okay? Do what thou wilt is the whole of their law, okay? And that's what they want to do. And so they're doing all these science things, which, you know, most of the scientists are even deceived through the magic of math that Satan has been working on for thousands of years. You go back 500 years when the real sorcerers gained all this sudden knowledge of how the earth is actually going around the sun at 66,000 miles an hour with no parallax at all, right? It's ridiculous on its face. And these black holes, I believe, could have something to do with the portals that Enoch is talking about. That's all I'm saying. And they want to find a way that they can control something referring to the sun and the moon so that they can change something referring to the sun and the moon. I mean, that would be one heck of a deception if they could figure a way, you know, based on these portals. I mean, when we see eclipses and the like, there's no accident why the moon and the sun are exactly the same size and all these various things. And Enoch spells it all out, but I don't really fully understand it. But I understand enough to know that nothing is going into outer space. It's just not happening. Period. What we see is something far beyond what most people can even imagine. But if you look at it from a spiritual, biblical point of view, you know that there's a spiritual war going on above you, and it's manifesting itself in the earth through all these evils and lusts and all this darkness that people are talking about now, days of darkness. They want to be able to make days of darkness. the evil ones would love to be able to create 3 days of darkness, because that would just allow them to fool the world. I mean, these are the things they're up to, the devices they're devising. It goes to that depth. So, you know, you got to just keep these things in mind. Nothing they tell you is what it seems. It's just unfortunately that way. And most of them are deceived. So you got to pray for them. You got to pray that they come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and know that they can't figure this stuff out with all their PhDs and math certificates. It's all a big lie. You can't lean on our own carnal understanding. But they're going to keep trying. You better believe it. And they'll take as many of us down with them as they can. So always be armored up. That's all I can tell you. It is of paramount importance. All of this stuff, it's just fakery, ritualistic magic to deceive the world. But most of the people that work at these agencies are compartmentalized and deceived. But a lot of them aren't. It is that evil, and people will go to that lengths for a job, for a paycheck. They'll sign a non-disclosure, and they'll become actors for NASA.
Very quickly did Rome and papal agents like the Jesuits begin to push this new cosmology. She took over astronomy and either pushed out or killed off anyone who contradicted the idea that the Earth was a globe spinning in space and revolving around the sun. Even those that met her halfway didn't keep her happy, and she dealt with them as well. Teague Ottensen Brahe, whose nickname was Tycho, accepted the idea that the Earth was a globe spinning in space, but still believed that his own observations and data proved that the Earth was the center of the solar system and not the sun. This is known as geocentrism. Tycho wanted to follow in the steps of Martin Luther and studied at the University of Wittenberg, but was forced out by the plague. Brahe's life appeared to be frequently in danger, and in 1566 he lost a large portion of his nose in a duel. He was 20 years old at the time. He later died under mysterious circumstances at the very young age of 54. One of those who claimed it was simply an illness, a bladder infection contracted during a banquet in Prague, was his understudy Johannes Kepler. Kepler was a German astronomer and supposedly a Lutheran, yet he had an intimate relationship with Jesuits. In 1597, Archduke Franz Ferdinand II of Austria banished all Protestants, good Roman Catholic that he was, and Kepler fled to Hungary. But the Jesuits intervened and convinced Ferdinand to allow him to return. Kepler grew up with a Jesuit uncle under the same roof of their house in Wildestadt. Uncle Sedaldus was a Jesuit astrologer who also kept a wife. Upon the unexpected death of Tycho Brahe, Holy Roman Emperor Rudolf II immediately promoted Kepler to replace him as imperial mathematician, and Kepler very quickly went to work rewriting all of Brahe's observations to be interpreted as heliocentric and not geocentric. In a paper titled Kepler's Relation to the Jesuits, Dr. Jörg Schuppner at the University of Leipzig noted that it is well known that the Order of the Jesuits was the most important and the most active Catholic order in the field of science during the 17th and 18th centuries. One field of particularly intensive successful study carried out by the Jesuits was astronomy. Many of their names are associated with the important discoveries in the history of astronomy, such as the discovery and mapping of moon craters. It is nearly impossible to list all the names of those who made serious contributions as astronomers or mathematicians. One aspect of the considerable role the Jesuits played in the history of astronomy was their support of Johannes Kepler. Some of them stood in extensive correspondence with Kepler. Now, it was obvious to protesters like Luther and Calvin that something fishy was going on in Rome, and the papacy needed plausible deniability while she rewrote our reality. That propaganda was presented by Italian astronomer and mathematician Galileo Galilei, and it's absolutely fascinating what user-edited Wikipedia says. In the entry for Galileo Galilei under the subtitle Galileo, Kepler, and Theories of Tides, Cardinal Bellarmine had written in 1615 that the Copernican system could not be defended without, quote, a true physical demonstration that the sun does not circle the earth, but the earth circles the sun. Galileo considered his theory of the tides to provide that required proof of the motion of the earth. Now, there's no link on the name Cardinal Bellarmine, which is unusual for Wikipedia. Maybe that's because Cardinal Bellarmine was Robert Bellarmine of the Society of Jesus, one of the most powerful Jesuits of his time, who was canonized a saint in 1930 and named a doctor of the church. What's more, it is ludicrous to imagine that the Earth's supposed large mass doesn't pull the moon and crash into it, and instead, the magical force of gravity holds it stationary. Even more ridiculous is the idea that the moon affects tides by pulling on the water. Again, the magical, mystical force of gravity is blamed. South African author Thomas Winship wrote in 1899 his book Zetetic Cosmogony, "If the moon lifted up the water, it is evident that near the land the water would be drawn away and low instead of high tide caused. Again, the velocity and path of the moon are uniform, and it follows that if she exerted any influence on the earth, that influence could only be a uniform influence. But the tides are not uniform." And Winship uses examples from South Africa. At Port Natal, the rise and fall is about 6 feet, while at Beira, about 600 miles up the coast, the rise and fall is 26 feet. This effectually settles the matter that the moon has no influence on the tides. But Protestant reformers were on to Rome. She knew she needed a smokescreen, and she provided it. Suddenly, history was rewritten, and rather than pushing with her own agents, like Copernicus, Kepler, Galileo, and others, to rewrite our cosmology, suddenly, the papacy was a defender of the flat earth. Well, just look what they did to poor Galileo. Let's do. Supposedly, Galileo was tried for heresy at the hands of that evil flat earther, Jesuit Robert Bellarmine. He bravely stood by his guns and humiliated the church with a heliocentric spinning ball earth. What happened to Galileo Galilei? Well, for the last few years of his life, he was put under house arrest. Have you read anything about the Inquisition? Do you know what the Inquisition did to people when it truly considered them an enemy? Things like rotating their arms backwards until they were pulled out of their sockets? Inventing special instruments that could be jammed into a person's body to rip open their bowels? Putting them in a special sarcophagus filled with spikes that would jam into them to the bone? Did you ever hear of Edgar Allan Poe? Are you familiar with his short story, The Pit and the Pendulum? About a swinging, razor-sharp pendulum that lowered across a victim and would take hours to slowly saw that victim in half. Did you know it was based upon the Inquisition? A little-known secret is that the Jesuits now own astronomy.
And in case there are any conspiracy theorists out there, how would you prove to us that you're in zero gravity?
Major Tom. Dr. Tom.
Miles to 25,000 miles above the Earth.
We went right out through them.
No effects on yourselves?
Didn't even know it. I don't think anybody, well, maybe somebody said you went through the radiation belt, but we didn't feel it inside and we didn't get any, you know, added radiation.
Yeah, if you pretend that it's not really there, then you can just go right through it.
I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again. To the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again. The only limit to a human future is in our own imagination.
I was going to say thank you very much. I mean, that's, as a science journalist, my question is, through your career and your writing and your acting, you've inspired so many people to enter the sciences. How do you balance science with science fiction?
They're both the same.
I'm excited about it. And the idea is to democratize space, to lower the cost of getting to many destinations in our solar system. And the reason you do this, everybody, the reason a society does this, there are two questions, Lauren, that we have all asked. Where did we come from? How did we all get here? Where did we come from? And are we alone in the universe? And if you want to answer those two questions, you have to explore space.
Well, I think it looks so ridiculous and impossible. You can tell it's real because it looks so fake, honestly. We'd have way better CGI if it was fake. And, you know, the colors all look like kind of weird in space. There's no atmospheric occlusion. You know, like everything looks too crisp. I mean, it's kind of silly and fun, but I think that's, you know, silly fun things are important. And I think that's just the imagery of it is something that's going to get people excited around the world. And it's still tripping me out. I mean, I'm tripping balls here. Well, I think it looks so ridiculous and impossible. You can tell it's real because it looks so fake, honestly. We'd have way better CGI if it was fake. And it's still tripping me out because it looks so fake, honestly.
The theory has gained momentum when NASA admitted that it had lost the original footage of man's first steps on the moon.
Because we didn't go there, and that's the way it happened, because we didn't go there.
Bazinga.
Pictures of all your crewmates, and they look perfectly normal to you. But when a picture like this gets down on Earth, you get instructed to take a picture like this. And astronauts are really, really good at making pictures in space that look like you've never left the planet. In fact, it's almost hard-pressed to tell whether you're in space or not in this picture. You know, we've got some fancy backdrops, I guess.
Lopes, you realize you just slide your ass off to your wife and your mother.
I know.
You have a whole series of O-rings in here and a shaft that you rotate. So, I mean, like on the space station, how many of these would you have?
Seven, because we have seven windows.
What happens if you get a leak on that?
Then you have a leak.
Then you have a leak.
You just have a leak.
And what you would do
is... You lose air.
You got it.
Okay, I got it.
And this is how stupid that they think you are. So if you have a friend who is a big NASA fanboy or girl, show this to them. Watch them scramble to think of excuses for NASA being caught in yet another steaming pile of BS.
And all of that happened in a little town called York, Maine, across the United States from where we're talking to you right now.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again.
Unfortunately, I'm not an astronaut. I've never been to space. But I've looked at these images over and over again, trying to sort of get the essence of it. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be.
Dulles brought in all the Nazi scientists and so forth. They went to two places. They went to CIA and they went to the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which in our world we call it not a space agency.
How do we know the Earth is not flat?
We don't. It's flat.
When their missionaries went across the world, across our flat Earth, the first thing they did was insinuate themselves in royal courts to become the official astronomer of that kingdom. China is a great example. One of the first Jesuits in China was Matteo Ricci. Ricci and his successors like Adam Schall and Ferdinand Verbiest were all the royal court astronomers and eventually fabricated the calendar for the Chinese emperor. Today, the Jesuits even have their own observatories both in Italy and in America. They use their puppets in American government to steal Apache holy ground on Mount Graham in Arizona. Are they reaching out extraterrestrially or interdimensionally? They appear to have answered our question with the latest piece of technology on Mount Graham, the large binocular telescope near-infrared utility with camera and integral field unit for extragalactic research, also known as Lucifer. And it's not surprising, given the success the Jesuits have had in rewriting our reality. Now, we're supposed to believe that Rome was against the spinning ball Earth heliocentric cosmic accident cosmology of our modern understanding. Yet at every step of the way, Jesuits or Jesuit agents were there to bolster our false reality, hiding whenever possible behind convenient Jews.
This next generation spacecraft will enable America to explore beyond low Earth orbit.
We must solve these challenges before we send people through this region of space.
Right now, we only can fly in Earth orbit. That's the farthest that we can go.
The kinds of technologies that we're testing out on space station are definitely helping us with our goals of going beyond low Earth orbit.
Early in the next decade, a set of crewed flights will test and prove the systems required for exploration beyond low Earth orbit.
Trouble in space this morning as the International Space Crew attempted a spacewalk outside the station. Here's a live look at the astronauts. Well, I don't believe.
Where's their spacesuit?
Oh, how amazed were you to see your roadster up there with Starman just cruising along with the Blue Planet? And how long will we be getting live views, do you think, from the car?
Well, I think it looks so ridiculous and impossible. And you can tell it's real because it looks so fake, honestly.
There will be an event where Muslims will give up Muhammad and Allah. There will be lukewarm Christians who give up Jesus Christ. There will be Buddhists that give up Buddha. All across the major religions, they will give up worship of their so-called gods in favor of this new deity. And for those of you that follow my channel and others like it, I mean, that is why this whole alien deception or demons manifesting in physical form as aliens is so intriguing. Because I honestly cannot think of a single event that would make worshipers of all the world's religions drop what they are worshiping today in favor of this new deity, unless it were supernatural, it was out of this world. And as Hollywood so eloquently shows us, you know, people do come together in awe and wonder, wanting wisdom and knowledge. I've tied that in together for you guys as well. In the Garden of Adam and Eve, they were tempted by knowledge and wisdom. If you look all throughout the occult and all the videos that I've done for you, all the hand symbol gestures and the all-seeing eye, it is all about occult wisdom and knowledge and enlightenment and rebirth. And so in the end times, it makes sense that the same trick will be played on us, that we will be seeking knowledge and wisdom. And it's almost unanimous that when we think about extraterrestrials, we think of them as having superior knowledge and wisdom. It's a very interesting theory.
Today we're taking a crucial step to secure America's future in space by reviving the National Space Council after it has been dormant almost 25 years, if you can believe it. Today's announcement sends a clear signal to the world that we are restoring America's proud legacy of leadership in space. Our Vice President cares very deeply about space policy. And for good reason. Space exploration is not only essential to our character as a nation, but also our economy and our great nation's security. The human soul yearns for discovery. By unlocking the mysteries of the universe, we unlock truths within ourselves. That's true. Our journey into space will not only make us stronger and more prosperous, but will unite us behind grand ambitions and bring us all closer together. Wouldn't that be nice? But will unite us behind grand ambitions and bring us all closer together. Wouldn't that be nice? Every launch into the skies is another step forward toward a future where our differences seem small against the vast expanse of our common humanity. Sometimes you have to view things from a distance in order to see the real truth. It is America's destiny to be at the forefront of humanity's eternal quest for knowledge. It is America's destiny to be at the forefront of humanity's eternal quest for knowledge.
And so in the end times, it makes sense that the same trick will be played on us, that we will be seeking knowledge and wisdom.
A lot of them out there, right? Infinity and beyond. There's infinity. Could be infinity. We really don't know. There's got to be something, but it could be infinity, right?
At some point in the future, we're going to look back and say, how did we do it without space?
Sure, here. I mean, does the Space Force have the full support of the Biden administration, or is the president at some point perhaps going to try to get rid of it or in some way diminish it?
They absolutely have the full support of the Biden administration, and we are not revisiting the decision to establish the Space Force. The desire for the Department of Defense to focus greater attention and resources on the growing security challenges in space has long been a bipartisan issue, informed by numerous independent commissions and studies conducted across multiple administrations, and thousands of men and women proudly serve in the Space Force.
If I say that the world is round and someone else says it's flat, that's worth reporting. But you might also want to report on a bunch of scientific evidence that seems to support the notion that the world is round. If some of these folks were around when Columbus set sail, they must have been founding members of the Flat Earth Society. They would not have believed that the world was round.
They'd be charter members of the Flat Earth Society.
In other breaking news, the world is round, not flat.
some of the things that I know. To try to wake people up and impart this knowledge to them.
My administration is reclaiming America's heritage as the world's greatest spacefaring nation.
Actually, how was sending those two astronauts to the moon supposed to get me reelected? Exactly.
We haven't been to the moon for 50 years.
Because we didn't go there, and that's the way it happened. And
thought it would look good.
And in December, I signed a historic directive that will return Americans to the moon for the first time since 1972.
Because we didn't go there, and that's the way it happened. And
while you were all whining about climate change and human rights and whale's dicks, this is what we were doing.
Very importantly, I'm hereby directing to establish a Space Force as the sixth branch of the armed forces.
May I present you with the Mars exploration ship, the USS George W. Bush.
When it comes to defending America, it is not enough to merely have an American presence in space. We must have American dominance.
But against who?
Against everybody!
This time, we will do more than plant our flag and leave our footprints. We will establish a long-term presence.
The moon is American soil. Moon flag, stars and stripes. Who beat the moon Nazis? We did.
And build the foundation for an eventual mission to Mars.
May I present you with the Mars exploration ship.
Mars exploration?
American space exploration.
This.
G'day mates, this is Australian ship Dundee 01, ready to kick ass.
Spitfire reporting in.
This is an outrage. You're all liars, just like my ex-husband. Okay, who didn't arm their spaceships? Oh, great. Great, that's just great.
The world is sick, but we are the doctors.
To free the Earth from the miseries of disease.
With hard work. With honesty.
We will face challenges, but we will get the job done.
We are the product of loving mothers.
Mothers and children trapped in poverty.
We are the gift of both God and science.
We will be protected by God.
We are the promise delivered to all mankind.
We will shine for everyone to follow.
For that, we raise our hand to one nation.
America first.
We step to the beat of one drum.
We are the people who carry the children on our shoulders, the same way that our fathers carried us and their fathers carried them.
But that is the past. And now we are looking only to the future.
There are a lot of so-called truthers that think they are close to the truth, but they don't understand everything they're told is nothing but a lie. And that also includes, as I've said, stated many times, the so-called ball earth. Let's take a look at the foundation when it comes to Freemasonry. Of course, an international organization. And why do they use the so-called square, which is a measuring tool, and the compass? Okay, a square, first off, has four corners, and this one doesn't. Okay? Let's take a look here from the Bible, Job 26:10. Referring to God, he hath compassed the waters with bounds until the day and night comes to an end. So the concept of a compass, as you see here, this is the foundation of the world we live in. Okay? You have the circle within a square and the ice ring that surrounds the flat earth. Okay? The compass, and these are your bounds with a compass. This is the entire foundation, of course. The concept of pillars as well is huge when it comes to Freemasonry. It's very simple once you understand the Bible. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. Okay, but this is how they do it with Freemasonry. Instead of putting God up here, they put Lucifer. Instead of a flat earth, they put a ball earth. This is how they do it. It's all about duality, as you see right in front of you with the black and white. Okay, all about duality. Now, taking a look here also at this Bible verse, just before I do so, again, the circle within the square. From Revelation 7:1, talks about the four angels standing on the four corners of the earth. Okay? A ball earth obviously does not have corners. This is the true concept representation of the biblical flat earth. Okay, let's move on here to these images and these Freemasons that have conceived this phony baloney ball earth. Take a look here at this artwork going back in time. Of course, you can see the ball earth, the moon, and the so-called Milky Way. This goes back to 1918. This was all conceived by Freemason Władysław Benda. Okay, let's take a look here again at the details. Earth with the Milky Way and moon, 1918. Okay, how do they know how the so-called ball earth looked like going back in time when the very first so-called photo of the ball earth was from 1946? Okay? It's only a partial image. And give me a break. Look at these clouds. Look at this supposed shadow on the ball earth. It's a complete joke. Okay? These Masons came up with the whole entire concept. I'll show some more details here once again with this supposed concept. Here's the details again from 1918. It's done with charcoal and originally appeared in March 1918 edition of Cosmopolitan along with an article titled The Future of the Earth. Okay? This is your future, the future of the Earth. Going back to 1918, the whole entire concept. Going back also in time as well here with Universal Pictures. From 1927 to 1936, this was their logo that appeared before movies played. Okay? Again, pre-1946, before the supposed first photo of the ball earth. How is it possible so accurate with current day globes? Okay? Just look at this teacher, basically brainwashing these children. Understand, he's unknowingly doing this. She was also taught years ago that we live in a ball. So it's passed on from generation to generation to generation, the lies. Same entire concept. You go to your dentist and all dentists believe fluoride is good for you. And why is that? Because the government tells you so. They read the information, they read the pamphlets, they read the literature. Look what it says here. This is government's official website, the cdc.gov fluoridation. Brush with fluoride toothpaste. Visit the dentist regularly. Drink water with fluoride. So the same people that understand the whole entire concept of fluoride not being good for you, they can't get away from the lies of this phony baloney ball earth. You ask your teacher, how does water stick to the bottom of the ball earth? And they just simply tell you gravity. And you say, okay, well, everybody else believes it, so I guess it must be true. Just because everybody else believes it. Now, I talk about truth in movies and lies in the news in the school textbooks. Here's a perfect example going back to 1983 with this TV series called V for Visitors. You see the Supreme Leader, Diana, and what does she have right in front of her? Let's take a closer look. You have the four corners, you have the dome, the firmament, and you see the sun and the moon within, and you see the circular motion within. This is flat out mockery.
Are images that inspire, educate, and sometimes just make us say, wow. Over the years, NASA has given us spectacular photos and renderings that reveal a colorful and mysterious universe.
No doubt. And now Chris Martinez is introducing us to two of the artists behind some of the most iconic space art in the galaxy.
In a small bright office, working side by side.
Let's see.
Robert Hurt and Tim Pyle bring the universe to life.
What we're doing does have real science underlying it.
All many fish. Revelation 12:1, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. We're all very familiar with that. That's a sign that we all are looking at as in the future is coming up. There are some that say that it actually took place a couple years ago, but nonetheless, this is what the general consensus is. Revelation 12:7, and there was a war in heaven. This is taking place at the same time that John sees the great sign in heaven. He also sees the war in heaven. He sees Michael the archangel and his angels fight the dragon. Okay? He sees the dragon cast out, the old serpent, the devil and Satan that deceives the whole world, and he's cast into the earth. This is what John is seeing and prophesying. This is all happening at the same time in John's prophecy. So this is a future event. And there are other scriptures that would suggest that the war in heaven was in the past. Well, I contend that the war in heaven is ongoing, and it will continue to be ongoing until this prophecy is fulfilled. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because we can actually see these dark forces that are manifesting themselves here on Earth. These are those spiritual gods. These are those spiritual gods that was cast out. The devil, Satan, and all his angels were cast out with him. These are those angels that the manifestation in men, elite, blue bloods, whatever you want to call them, the globalists, the New World Order, what they are doing is pursuing Satan's New World Order, and they're doing it with his marching orders, and they're fighting this war, yes, in this physical realm, for what we see politically, geopolitically, and all the insane policies and monetary policies and transgender insanity and That's all just the earthly, fleshly glitz. The real battle's in the spiritual realm, ladies and gentlemen, and they throw it right in front of us every single day.
May 18th, 1969, Apollo 10 view of Earth. And I had to bookmark it and come back to it today. It claims that this is a view from 36,000 nautical miles away as photographed from the Apollo 10 spacecraft during its translunar journey toward the moon. Yucatan Peninsula, or that's obscured by clouds. Nearly all of Mexico, north of the Isthmus of Tehuantepec, can be clearly delineated. The Gulf of California and Baja and the San Joaquin Valley can be easily identified. Yep. Well, I used to live in Arizona, so that would put me like right over in here, if that's supposed to be the Gulf of California. By the way, I mean, just this series of numbers right here alone is every combination you can think of in their little occult gang is in this combination of numbers here. Primarily 666 and the duality 69969. There's a lot there. Not only that, you got 36,000, right? Every single thing they tell us is either in miles or kilometers. Always, always. But this time, we use nautical miles. Why? Well, let's find out. Because if we convert them to metric, to kilometers, well, looky here, 36,000 nautical miles is 666. 666. 666, 666. It's a master number. It's the number of the beast. The beast that runs this whole program, and now it's permeating itself throughout the entire internet. And that's just the way it is. Get your spiritual house in order, please, and be prompt about it. This is supposed to be the Earth from 36,000 nautical miles. And this is supposed to be the Gulf of California, San Joaquin. That would put Arizona over here, Texas over here. Well, gee whiz, where does Mexico go? It's totally disproportionate. There's a giant serpent over Houston, Texas. Canada's missing altogether. Do you see how bad it is that they actually have people believing this? And they are just rolling, laughing at the absolute ignorance of the general population.
There's artistry to creating the world.
What I imagine it to be. Unfortunately, I'm not an astronaut. I've never been to space. But I've looked at these images over and over again, trying to sort of get the essence of it. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be. It is Photoshopped, but it's has to be.
And I cannot help but try and at least locate one of those people who believe these things still and get them to look at it and understand that they're dealing with some serious principalities. Sooner or later, it's going to come to a point where this beast in this system is going to say, okay, now we're going to play by my rules. And you can see them setting it all up. So when it comes, I hope you're ready. I do not know what this mark will be, but you will be required if you want to participate in the services provided over this worldwide web. You are going to need to have an identifier, a specific identifier, a number, if you will, or you will not be able to participate in commerce. That's the way it's going to go down. So please get your house in order. Contemplate what I'm telling you and ask for the truth.
Okay. Same entire concept where it states in the Bible, once again, as I've shown before, it says from the very beginning of the Bible in Genesis chapter 1, verse 14, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons.
Thank you.
So if you are a Bible believer and you read this verse and you still go along with science that the sun and the moon, you know, are in distant space, with the sun supposedly being 93 million miles away and the moon being 238,000 miles away, you are rejecting God's word. What does the Bible say about rejecting God's word? From Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. So again, you substitute what science tells you and all their textbooks about evolution. You understand that's a lie, but for some reason you're going to go along with what science says and reject God's word. Okay, that's what it all comes down to. Look how these Masons love to mock those that own and control our society. Let's take a look here. This is a cross street off Ventura in LA. They have Furman Avenue. This is exactly how they mock. People are driving by the street, you know, every day, night, going to their 9-to-5. Job and are clueless to what's right in front of them. Now, the question I get asked daily, why would they lie to us about living on a ball earth when we actually live on a flat earth? It's all about trying to disprove God. The ball earth concept basically supports the theory of evolution with the Big Bang. Basically, from an explosion was the exact opposite of creation. An explosion destroys things. It does not create things. The whole idea from the Big Bang, how this world supposedly formed, and how it constantly spins at the same rate of speed year after year. Again, it's all about supporting the theory of evolution, trying to disprove God, make this believe, again, that we came from this supposed explosion.
1,500 years ago, everybody knew the Earth was the center of the universe. 500 years ago, everybody knew the Earth was flat.
Man reaches the edge. After he goes as far as any man can possibly go, how does his son continue?
Fools,
They are everywhere.
Cheers.
Not a compliment. And they come in all shapes and sizes. Here we go. Who better to test the new foolproof iPhone app from Sportsbet than these Einsteins?
I personally believe that apps like such as Sportsbet, they make it easier for people to use, such as some
people. I'm with you. Yep, it's so easy. Even Botox Bradley here can use it without raising an eyebrow.
I'll never botch your head-to-head again.
And you make it look so natural. Carol here thinks she's about to inherit a Nigerian fortune. You know, love mightn't come easy, but Sportsbet's new iPhone app sure does.
Seems too good to be true.
Unlike your imaginary prince. Seriously, even flat earth expert Mark Sargent could use it. A bloke who thinks space is fake.
I could do this standing on my head.
Thanks, gravity. Even this idiot abroad can use it.
Yeah, it's dead easy.
Ausbomben!
See you in the NT News, mate.
And we gotta save those people by making them learn about things that maybe they don't know.
I'll tell you what I do know. Even the permanently offended can claim a winner winner chicken. Oh, sorry, vegan based dinner.
So easy. It's outrageous!
It's a beauty.
It'll make a splash, all right. At least that's what former rugby league whiz kid Todd Carney believes.
Yeah, it's a piece of piss. It's better when it's flat.
He's just a tad bit light, that's all.
Because they're not real things, because aliens are not real. Jesus is.
The all-new iPhone app from Sportsbet. It's foolproof.
Thanks, Sportsbet.
Mark, I put it to you, you're talking utter nonsense.
It's obviously utter nonsense. It's obviously insanity. In fact, I encourage anyone that's listening to the sound of my voice, don't Google flat earth.
don't do it.
Take my word for it. I could be a mental patient recently released from an institution.
Needing to contrive an origin for our accidental existence that contradicts the Bible. Jesuit-trained Belgian priest Georges Lemaître is the father of the so-called Big Bang Theory, the idea that first there was nothing and then it exploded. He was a close co-worker of just such a Jewish puppet, Albert Einstein. Einstein bolstered the Jesuit cosmology with his convoluted theory of relativity. The problem was that observations of both scientists and laymen weren't matching what so-called astronomers were telling us. And so Einstein fabricated the theory of relativity to claim that your reality was relative to the time-space continuum. It is purposefully almost impossible to understand. You're just supposed to trust science and astronomy. The Jesuits then jumped on with dinosaurs and Charles Darwin to claim the Earth is billions of years old. And wherever Darwin's theory of evolution had holes, Jesuits stepped up to fill the gap. Jesuits like Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, the father of the New Age, after fabricating the ape-like pre-humans that we supposedly came from, even students of evolution became concerned that there was a, quote, missing link between primitive apes and modern humans. A discovery was made in 1912 to bridge that gap. Having been found in Piltdown, East Sussex, England, it was named Piltdown Man. Unfortunately, it was also found to be a hoax. The skull of a small human with the altered mandible and teeth of an orangutan. Sometime later, paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould uncovered the father of that hoax, a Jesuit priest named Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. There are many such examples in archaeology and paleontology, and yet, no one asks, why would so-called scientists be fabricating evidence? The goal was to discredit the Bible, and it has been resoundingly successful. Without the spinning ball Earth, Darwinian dinosaur cosmic accident, the Bible is a science textbook. With it, critics laugh and question the Bible, and instead look to human authorities to save their souls, such as the Vicar of Christ himself, who is for the first time in Roman Catholic history, a Jesuit priest.
If we turn against each other based on divisions of race or religion,
come on, try getting it out.
Bing, 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 bing.
That's all, folks.